absolutely beautiful. What we have here, friends, is motherwort. And greetings, Puma Ghostwalker here. It's June 7th, 2015, and we're actually on the 60-acre wooded parcel that I live in New York City, off the grid, in my camper. Some of the time. The other time I'm out backpacking, living in my tent. But I've been searching for this several years ago when I first moved onto this property. I totaled, I would say, planting about a billion wildflower seeds. And in that number was from wild harvesting motherwort the year before. I filtered out the last bit of it and collected all the seeds, and I sowed the seeds on this property as well. And as you look out over here, we have some of the results of my hard work. So we are going to harvest this. Oh, I should add that this next video presentation will be about medicinal herbs. So we'll start with motherwort. And here we have the three-lobed, pretty raggedy here, motherwort. The genus and species are, the genus actually comes from the lion's tail, and the species, a Greek word meaning helping cardiac. So this plant here is really good. I want to point out that it's in the mint family, and you can see the squared stem here. And it's actually a bit concave in the center, which makes the edges, the four sides, a bit pronounced. So we have the upper leaves here that are three-lobed, but down below they're almost they're five-lobed and almost palmate. But here, very classic square stems. I hope it's really hard sometimes to pick up, you know, some definition, but we'll get some various sun and angles here, and it's so clear to me anyways, the square stems. What a beautiful plant. It's in bloom right now, and the best time to harvest it, if you're going to use it as a dry herb making teas, for instance. But later on I will do another harvest and make a tincture out of that for future tonics. But just look at these beautiful flowers, and they're really hairy, and this is the optimum time to pick. It's really good for calming. I actually use this herb a lot, and I carry it with me all of my adventures. Culpeper even once wrote about its calming effects of melancholy. So this plant is really popular and dates back hundreds of years in Europe and thousands of years in Asia. The Japanese even have a holiday every ninth day of September is a motherwort festivity. So with that said, we are going to clip the top portions here where the flowers are, and I have a huge area to work with. And then later on, if it reflowers especially, but I'm not going to do all the flowers right now. There's more than I need here. This is a huge, huge clump of motherwort, and it goes on up over the hill there. And there's other places too that I came across this, but this is the biggest patch, and it's really amazing. But some of its other qualities, it's really good, and hence the name motherwort. It's really good for women. It's really good for women's cramps and menstruating, and will help ease a lot of the pain. It's really good for soft muscle relaxation, hence, you know, the crampings and whatnot. It's good for, it's not gender specific though. It's good for men as well. I use it. It really helps calm me a lot. I have a lot of stomach problems, and it really helps relax me. So I use it. And in this video presentation, we'll be doing various harvesting procedures and then procedures on actually using it as a medicine.
Well, as I said, I was going to harvest some of this motherwort, and I'll probably take this into probably three small clumps, rubber band them up and hang them upside down in my camper behind me. And as they dry, once they dry out, so you can use the stems, I'll probably strip the stems and just use all the leaves and flowers for herbal tea. And I just picked a very small amount. This is all I need for my herbal teas in the future. And I will do one more harvest later, and we will make that for a tincture, like I said, for tonics, a combination of herbs. So I will have a tincture of motherwort, and I think on this video presentation, I already have a tincture of heal all or self heal, curing right now in pure grain alcohol, and shortly, as part of this video presentation, we will strain out all of the vegetative matter, the mark, and discard that and filter and just have a pure 2-to-1 concentration of self-heal. And we are going to also harvest some ghost plant, hopefully, soon. And that is a mild sedative. And if you have all of these tinctures here, instead of using the dry product, you can just use the concentrated herb and pure grain alcohol and combine it with other herbs to make tonics. So that's in the future, but right now we are going to bundle this up and hang it upside down and dry it out real nice, and then we'll jar it or bag it, depending on what I have. Just wanted to point out, while I was walking back to my camper, we have some blue-eyed grass here. Really beautiful. I love this time of year. I love all the times of year, but spring is just amazing. Blue-eyed grass. And we have a little mugwort here. We'll talk about that in the fall for sure. And look at there. My truck and camper. In a tent. Well, and here they are. All prepared. Hanging upside down so nicely, as I said, in my camper. But I wanted to notice, you know, and point out once again the whorls here. Opposing leaves. And the calyx here, the hull, the husk, where the seeds eventually will reside, really will harden, and when it dries out will get really, really sharp and prickly. But it's also good, like I said, it's good for calming and relaxing soft tissue muscle. It's great for women's menstruation problems. It's a good heart strengthener, and it really helps ease tensions and stress, heart palpitations. It's really good for, you know, fast heart palpitations and the calming of, like I said, these soft muscle tissues. And I just wanted to do one last bit there while they're drying out and looking so wonderful here. They're not really very fragrant, so there'll be other herbs that will just fill my camper with wonderful aromas, but not motherwort. Well, here we are back at the biggest patch of motherwort that I have on this 60-acre piece of property that
I live on, and I'm pretty confident that the several patches that I have here on this property is the result of my sowing of seeds that I had harvested outside of this location and brought them here, and really, really put a lot of motherwort in various areas, and this was one. Not all the areas took, but several did, and most of the open land here on the 60 acre property is covered in mugwort, which I harvest as well, but I usually do it when it comes into flower. As we can see, the motherwort here is in bloom. Notice the little whorls here on opposite leaf stems, and they're really, really quite beautiful little fuzzy pink things that almost remind me of orchids in a way. But it's amazing how prolific they are, and they are actually muscling out the mugwort. And up in here, there is no more mugwort, and it has just completely choked it out. And that is amazing to me, because mugwort usually chokes everything else out. So I would say that this motherwort is here to stay. And as we walk around this really enormous mound, it is quite incredible to see actually how far, you know, this patch goes and grows, and it will, I believe, will expand every year more and more. And one thing's for certain, time will tell. So here's a few things. Here's some just starting over here, flowering. And when you're out here plant identifying, you want to view a plant in all of its stages. Here's a first year growth. It won't flower this year, but next year it will flower for sure. This is flowering. This is very young and flowering. But here we have, and they seem to be, you know, three lobed here, deeply cleft, almost palmate. As the plant matures next year, the lower leaves will get much wider. And here we have some evidence of last year's flowering. Notice the calyx here, very, and where the seed resides is inside here, which here on a more mature, hard to see in here, but underneath the flower is the calyx, which will bear the seed, and they're really spiny and prickly as they mature. And the seeds here have been dispersed so neatly. The seeds are really interesting looking. They're kind of cone shaped with a point, almost, I'd say, like an ice cream cone. Has a point on one end and then comes up a bit rounded at the top. So this is really important for me, is that when you're out here, and even in the dead of winter, you come across something like this and it's all bearing, and you say, ah, motherwort. You know exactly what it is because you have observed it in all of its seasons, and it's really important. And so, whoops. And we have come around here, and this is a wonderful patch. And again, here is some more of last year's. This was an enormous plant of, gee whiz, I'd say it's over 4 feet, so it's quite hardy. They like a shady area. So we have some black locusts here, and it's providing a nice soil. Last year's and this year's, but But look at this sight, and it's just really incredible. We're up on top of the mountain. We're going to swing back around, and we're going to do a little harvesting. We're making a tincture now. Our last harvest was for drying to make teas later. Once it's completely dried out, I will store it and use it. It'll probably be good for a year or two if I store it in a, you know, airtight mason jar, perhaps. And the tincture that we are going to make today should last several years. Well, let's get to harvesting. Always when I'm out harvesting, I like to bring these cloth bags, recyclable bags, as the material can breathe and not get all clammy on you. Like if you were to harvest in a plastic bag, let's say. So because of the abundance of this crop here, just got stabbed by one of the fresh calyx. I'm just doing the tips where the majority of the flowering is occurring, and the lovely whorls here are just so beautiful. Really is beautiful there. I can't think of a single look-alike. And there's no confusing this plant with anything else, that is for sure. Has more of a vegetative fragrance other than the flowering aroma, that's for sure. I can't really detect any sweet fragrance. A bumblebee over here, right in there, a small one, is doing some harvesting himself, herself, I would probably most guarantee. Anything above ground is harvestable, but I figure with such an enormous crop here, and this is just one of several that I have on site in the property here that I live in, I'm just going to do the very tops, and not all the tops, of course, of the whole crop, but even in a plant, there's a lot of, you know, divisions here as it matures, and I will leave them to propagate. I mean, they're very prolific, and I just can't believe how they're just muscling in on the mugwort. That makes me so happy. I mean, I love mugwort, but I have enough for a small nation. And it is really not necessary to harvest all of this because I don't need it. This tincture here will last me for quite a while. And the reason why I'm doing a tincture as well as for future tonics, where I will combine various herbs to complement each other for various ailments that I may have, or my friends that are close to me here. So I'm going to do a little bit more harvesting here, and I think that we're good. And we will, I'm going to leave that, go up here just a bit more. And as you can see, it's really amazing. And when you harvest, you want to harvest when they're in bloom, which they are right now. Perfect time. Perfect timing to do this harvest here of motherwort. And then we will go home and I'll show you how to prepare a tincture. It's really, really quite simple. We will do a 2-to-1 tincture. You could use 60 proof vodka. I almost always like to use the stronger spirit of pure grain alcohol. One product would be Everclear that we're quite familiar with here in the States. I'm actually using a Polish variety, but grain alcohol is grain alcohol.
Well, I do believe that this is sufficient, and if not, I could always walk across the park here and take a little bit more. But we've got quite a bounty here, and if I overpicked, I'll just bundle it up and hang it on the rack where I'm drying other motherwort.
Well, here we are, back on the section where I live of the 60 acre piece of property here. I still have my tent set up. And here are the lower limbs, and once again, look at how square these stems are, and just so typical of the mint family. And down below, we see here at the lower stem, and the lower leaf, I should say, see, it's almost palmate, if you will, deeply cleft, and much, much larger and different than the three-lobed, almost look like a sassafras there, just a wee bit. But up above, they're much smaller where they flower, and where the flowers come out in this lovely little whorl. Look at that. But I would say this is the first year they came up here. I haven't seen any dry. And it's just so amazing. The last 4 or 5 years I've been away backpacking the Appalachian Trail and various other adventures, gone all summer. And I have missed these. But they have come up in a big way here on the property. I'm really pleased about this. And so I'm not even gonna harvest this. Just gonna allow it to mature and seed and watch it just take over this area as well. Well, the honeybees love it, other pollinators, as the native bumblebee, really enjoy this flower, and I'm so happy to have it here on site.
Well, here we are, back at the camper. Wow, what a lovely outing. It's going to be about 90 degrees and pretty humid today. Right here we have a tincture of heal-all, or self-heal, that has been used in Europe for hundreds of years, and Asia for thousands, I'm sure of it. And I just wanted to point out, I received a new book in the post the other day. I haven't had a chance to start reading it. Pardon me. But this is medicinal plants of the Mountain West, the higher elevations in the Rockies and in Wyoming, the Tetons, and California, in the High Sierras. And this is by the famous herbalist Michael Moore, and not to be mistood from the filmmaker Michael Moore, but Michael Moore, the late Michael Moore, I should say, was an amazing herbalist and teacher, and have taught many. And this actually will complete my volume of all of his work. I have read all his other books, so I was excited about buying his final book and complete my collection. So I'll be reading this here real soon. And I wanted to point out that recently I have found that Michael has some videos on YouTube that somebody had hosted, and it's so wonderful now that when I read Michael, I can actually hear his voice as if he is reading it now, that I'm familiar with the way he speaks. Quite a character. I think that we would have gotten along quite well together. But a very, very wonderful man, and he is truly missed. So here we have some self-heal and pure grain alcohol. And what we do is I've jarred this about 3 weeks ago. I think 2 more weeks and it'll be good. Every day you want to take it out and you want to shake it a bit and really help draw out all of the constituents, Oops, it's leaking so much for a jar. What good is a jar that leaks? They just make crap these days. That's why, you know, good ball mason jar, it won't leak. But this is what I had to pick up at the time. But we will talk more about self-heal, or heal all, goes by various names, at a later time, about, you know, its constituents and its benefits. But for right now, let's get right to this. And I have a larger mason jar, but I just feel that I don't like to wash. I mean, you could, you know, make sure that there's no bugs, brown leaf like that, yeah, you could remove, but this is really prime vegetative. And it, you know, you gotta pack it in. And maybe we did over harvest a bit. I wasn't sure, because you can really, you know, fill this. And I was gonna use the larger jar that I have, and it will seal much better, I am sure. But I felt that I didn't have enough spirits to accommodate that large jar, and I could go to the liquor store and purchase more. But for now, I think that this will do quite well. Oh yes, this is a lot of material, but you really want to pack it in. All the way. I mean, really stuff it and just keep packing and packing and packing, and that you're gonna get your 2-to-1 ratio of herb and the delivery system of the grain alcohol. So yeah, I think we picked enough to do the large jar, like I said, but for now this will work. And really, as you keep pressing it, it's just amazing. You can fit a little bit more, a little bit more, and so far I don't have a puncture wound. From the almost burr-like calyx, really. I think we could probably fit a little more. There's always a little extra room in the stuffing. But I think that this will about get us there, though. And once again, we will let this sit in a dark space. Yeah, I keep it covered up there in the upper left. And I think we're good here. So, oh, good grief, yeah. Well, let's get some spirits in there. Yeah, trust me, I'll get it in. To use the pure grain alcohol. Good grief. Because it really helps pull out everything. Everything in the plant gives you a really, really good, powerful medicine. And like I said, enough. And you really want to fill it all the way up to the very top, so all of the plant matter is submerged. And with a good tight lid, we could pack this baby in there. I can get a little bit more spirits in here. crappy jar as well. Oops. But if it doesn't leak, I'll be pleased. And there we go. And there we have it. The second phase, first is harvesting, obviously, and then preparing the tincture. And now we will let it sit. And just like this, it'll extract all of the goodness. And then our next step here will be bottling, where we will remove it, we will filter it, and the vegetative mass here is now called a mark, M-A-R-C, and we will take the mark and filter, squeeze it out, probably use like a bandana, and put the mark in here and close it up, and we will wring it out and get every drop of goodness that the plant has to offer. And then we will run it probably through a coffee filter just to get any of the floaty bits out, and bottle it, cap it. It'll be good for several years. Well, until next time, my friends. What we have here is a jack in the pulpit. We're in probably the most fertile forest in New York City. It's called the Green Belt on Staten Island. And it really is an amazing place. And look at the shape of the leaves of the jack in the pulpit, and down below, and the poison ivy are almost identical. Curious, isn't it? But here we are, jack in the pulpit, and you can see it had already flowered, and it's such a beautiful flower, and it just comes out, jack in the pulpit, when it's mature. We'll have two stems, that's it, a tuber down below, and then this is the cob, and you can see it's still got the flower, decayed flower material around it. Very poisonous plant, and beautiful. You can't eat the tubers, but you gotta slice them up thin and let them dry for 6 months. I usually try to stay away from such things. For instance, if you usually have to boil it 3 or 4 times in order to eat it, I usually pass and look for something else. But that's just me. But here, at this most fertile forest in New York City, we are in the search for ghost plants. Some people call them Indian pipes. They don't create chlorophyll. They do not photosynthesize. And we are looking for them to harvest. They'll make a wonderful mild sedative that we are going to make a tincture. And that's why we're here. So let's pack up and head out. Well, I'm afraid it's a little too early for the ghost plants, and my predictions of other years were more July and August. It's the middle of June, but I wanted to get out here and start to hunt for them, and hopefully I'll still be around, or maybe not even hopefully. I'm waiting for Hollywood to finalize my new TV show, but this is a sweet gum tree, and gee whiz, it's really hard to show you the scale of how enormous this burl is, but that would make one hell of a bowl. It's pretty enormous, or a plate. I know some people would love to get their hands on a specimen like this. Greetings, friends. It's been some time since we have picked the motherwort and hung it to dry. We did pick an extra excess of the batch for our motherwort tincture here, where that is drying as well. And like I had said, and you can see the color here is really starting to really draw out, really a deep, deep green. And what we do is once a day, we shake it like this, and you can just see
all of the chlorophyll and all of everything that does the body good is coming out of the organic plant material. And here, this is the helol that we will be filtering shortly. But one of the next processes is making room. And here is my old supply of motherwort. I was going to harvest today, but the humidity rose as thunderstorms are rolling into the New York City area. And I may wait a day or two until they crisp up again, because the plant material of the drying motherwort has become a bit spongy today because of the higher humidity, and I don't want to package it if it still has some moisture in it, and then we're going to get some mold, some mildew, and contaminate our product. So I had mentioned earlier in the video presentation describing the motherwort seeds, and I often will use a piece of screening as a sieve. And I'll do something like this, and I can see the seeds right here. What I'll be doing is I am going to take the excess motherwort that I have right here and take advantage of the weather that is very wet, and we're going to have thunderstorms throughout today and into tonight, and I thought it would be a perfect time to sow the seeds. So with that said, I wanted to see if I could, look at those. I had described them as being like an ice cream cone and having a point at one end, and I can see all the seeds in there. So let's take a look. Let's see what we can see. Yeah, how about that? And there they are. Mugwort seeds, like I said, they kind of are like little ice cream cones, and I just wanted to show you that while we have the tools at hand. I love that lighted magnifying glass. So let's get outside and sow some seeds and do what's right, put it back to the earth. We do not waste anything. Well, here we are right in front of my camper. And as you can see, voila, right there. And motherwort came up right here for the first time, right in my front yard, so to speak. I live off the grid in the woods, so this is all my front yard. 60 acres, like I said, in New York City. I don't think no other New Yorker has real estate like this. So my plan is, and it's getting dark as we speak, and I'm going to sow the seeds. We're gonna get seeds from here, but They like it a little shady. They'll grow up against a wall. They like to grow underneath trees. Give them a partial shade and they will do well. And I wanted to point out that your dried plant for teas and decoctions are really good for about a year or two. A tincture, on the other hand, could last several years too, indefinitely. And I just wanted to point all that out. And before we conclude in this video, we still have much more preparation. Like I said, I'm hoping to harvest some ghost plants to include that in this video presentation. So if time allows, I will do so. And we will be harvesting the dried motherwort shortly, and then I'll probably put it all together, and then we will filter the tinctures and bottle them, that they're ready to go,
in their main bottling, and then from there we could put it into eyedropper bottles, and drops are really good for properly giving your dose for medicinal purposes. And the tincture is wonderful. Let's say like the tincture heal-all is really good for wounds inside and out. So then I could take the tincture and put it in my mortar with my pistol, and I can put in some comfrey, which is also good for wounds, and together combine them and use a poultice on for a first aid type situation for myself or somebody that's around me, if willing, of course. Well, thank you so much, and I look forward to the conclusion of this video presentation. And here's the dried motherwort once again, and it was very crisp yesterday or 2 days ago when it was very hot and low humidity. But I think I'm gonna wait a couple more days. Here's the other batch, and it's really drying out really nice, and it's going to last me the next season. I'll be taking it when I go away backpacking. And beautiful, got a lot of flowers, on this. Like I said, it's drying out really nicely, but I think I'd like to wait just a little longer. But we got rid of all of our leftover motherwort from last year to make room for the new batch. I'm excited. And here we are at my biggest patch. What a colony of motherwort here. And as you can see, I barely harvest anything from this colony in comparison. I would say I probably took 3% of what was here. So there'll be motherwort in the future. No doubt about that. Really is a beautiful, beautiful plant, I think, anyways. It's not native. It's been naturalized. It's ours now. Like I said, in the mint family. And really good medicine. I use it often. My cat always goes for hikes with me. He thinks he's a dog. And he likes to run up past me like a dog, too. I thought it would be a good time to sow these seeds that I don't need anymore. Well, here we are back at the motherwort growing just right outside in front of my trailer. And I just wanted to point out and identify this plant here. It's been used in Asia and Europe for hundreds, if not thousands, of years, and it's in the mint family, and with the square stem is what's characteristic in the mints itself. And here we have a secondary growth coming out of one of the five-lobed lower leaves, where they come up to then three-lobed at the top, and then the flowers here at the top, they bloom from down below. They don't all bloom at the same time. They start blooming from down below, and they continue blooming all the way up. And we'll notice here that the leaves are opposite instead of opposing. If they were opposing, let's say they would like zigzag, one here, one up there, then one over here, one over there. But here they are opposite,
and the flowers are in a whorl around the three-lobed leaves. But the big point is here down below, here's the calyx, and they're really spiny. They're starting to firm up, and they're really sharp, and the seeds are embedded within. So it's really easy to identify this. It's hard to mistake it for anything else, and it's such a beautiful plant. Now let's go inside, and we're going to be finishing the drying part of preparing the motherwort. So let's go do that now.
Well, I have quite the harvest this year, and much will go off to many of my friends in the future. And I'm going to do this in a couple of ways to help preserve the integrity of the plant and its flowers and everything. I'm going to start by loading it up in a mason jar at first, and this will store nicely. It'd be good for a year or two in this type of storage condition. And the remainder, probably all of this here, I will then strip out and bag it in a plastic Ziploc bag. And still it will remain fresh for a year or two. And at that point, you would want to reharvest and discard, like we did prior to the drying. It actually took a while for it to dry out. We've had so many thunderstorms, and the humidity here in the Northeast was just ridiculous and unbearable. So I could probably stuff a little bit more in here, but we'll cross that bridge in a moment. So here we had dried them out in bundles, and although it's not necessary, the stems are quite usable. I'm going to strip these out, and we'll go through that a little bit later, not to waste any. And as I was saying, motherwort's uses are really good for soft muscle relaxation. It's used by the name motherwort. It's used for women for hundreds of years and thousands of years in China for women's menstruation. And due to its ability to stimulate the soft muscle tissues, it's really good for a slow menstruation due to stress, and it's also good, and it's been used in Europe as a heart tonic, and it's really good for the release or the relief of tension, I should say. And that's what I use it for, and it works really well. I've been using this for many decades, and it works really well. It's really has no side effects. It's very mild, and could be used, you know, pretty frequently without any worries of side effects. But this is time consuming, and I don't want to run the video too long and out of control. To strip all this out, I think, would be a bit of a waste. But you get the point, and the calyx here are really starting to dig into my fingers as I'm stripping this out. So you get the point. You take, when using the dried, we have a tincture as well that we're still waiting. It's still in the preparation mode. And you would take about a handful like this, maybe a little bit more, and boil it in some water, steep it in some water, and strain it. And you could take it 2 to 3 times a day is what I would recommend. And here we have motherwort, a great herb. Well, here we have the finished product in its final stage, and jarred and packaged in a Ziploc container or vessel. And I would like to conclude in the drying part of the motherwort here by taking Michael Moore's medicinal plants of Mountain West, and behold, lo and behold, he has motherwort in it. So for the late great Michael Moore, I'd like to do a little bit of reading about what Michael wrote about motherwort. And he says here, the constituent, or one of the constituents, the chemicals in the plant that makes it all happen, says motherwort contains leoyurine and related alkaloids with a mild vasodilating effect, which means it's good for cramps. And here he says, it is most frequently employed for menstrual cramps associated with delayed menstruation caused by stress or illness. It is a traditional remedy in China used to help relax the muscles. And that's why I use it. I get really stressed out, and I've been using it for decades. I get stomach cramps and stomach upsets and palpitations. And it really has helped me a lot. And here, you know, he's Michael is referring to, has long been a home remedy in Europe as a mild cardiac tonic, as I mentioned earlier. Its real effect on the heart derives from the subtle but distinct suppression of thyroid function, helpful in stress-induced thyroid elevation, with little or no effect from simple adrenaline-induced palpitations. And here he says he's not referring to thyroid disease, but here the tendency for certain folks, subset of folks anyways, to increase thyroid levels under stress and decrease them under depression. And that's where he's referring. He's referring to thyroid knot disease, where sweating and rapid gut transit time and nervous lethargy is the primary symptoms. When in doubt, use a bugleweed, or they're very complementary to each other. So he says, you know, you could use them both together to help with the same symptoms. And the only contradictions is that because it's vasodilating, that you shouldn't use it during pregnancy. But he's also referred to where it's really good to use right after childbirth to really help the drainage of the and to help prevent where is that, you know, to help clarify the drainage and to help prevent urine infection. So it's really a wonderful herb. I swear by it. I've been using it for decades, and here it is, all ready to go. I'll have to put a fresh batch in my first aid kit in my backpack. I hope this is all helpful.
Now here is a beautiful and useful plant. Not only useful, and look here, it's just starting to flower, and they will flower from the bottom and continue on upwardly. They're really, really small flowers, as you can see. It is a native species here to North America, blue vervain, and it has multiple uses, but it's an excellent sedative. It'll help you sleep and help calm you, and I would imagine that it would really combine well with motherwort. And so we'll be harvesting this today. There's enough here that I'll be able to make a tincture, and with that tincture it will serve as a tonic, and we can combine it with other tinctures such as motherwort to really get some wonderful medicinal uses. As I was saying, it's actually native to North America. I don't believe it to be in the mint family, but it does have a hairy, really fine hair, square stem, and the leaves are long and toothed, really resembling a mint. They're really beautiful, and when you see them in a thick area, they just really stand out and really catch your eye. What an amazing plant. Well, before we start to harvest, in my new book of Michael Moore's, I haven't started reading it yet, but I'm reading the heck out of it because he's got a lot of great plants in this book. So I would like to read from and quote Michael Moore a little bit about blue vervain here that he has written. The late, great Michael Moore, I should say, and he is missed in the herbal community for sure. He's really, really very prominent in the West and in the Southwest, and I have, well, I will have read all of his books once I finish reading this one. It's so funny. So this is Michael. Vervain is broadly active medicinally, serving as a sedative, a diaphoretic, bitter tonic, and antispasmatic. It's one of the best for onset of a virus cold, particularly with upper respiratory inflammation. It will promote sweating, I imagine, like yarrow. It would be good in combination with yarrow. I'm sure that is me speaking. And I'm going to add my own thoughts as I read through Michael Moore's quotations here. It will promote sweating, like I said, and relax and soothe, allay feverishness, settle the stomach, and generally produce a feeling of relaxed well-being. Well, I think we all could use a little bit of that. Holy smokes, and that's a sedative speaking there. It is useful for children who've become fidgety and cranky when first falling ill, running around in a droopy, hyperactive fashion, or for the child who has spent 3 hours in bed and is bored to tears, but by no means well enough to go out and play in the snow, says Michael Moore. The dose for children is 1/2 to 1 teaspoons as needed, for adults up to a tablespoon. And we're talking of tincture here. Larger quantities of vervain can produce nausea and vomiting, so we don't want to do too much of that. The root was formerly the official plant used, but Michael says that the root itself has far greater nauseating effects. And so Michael suggests just taking the top part and just using the leaves and the flowers, which is what we will be doing here today. To dry it out and make a tea, which I'm not sure. If we have some extra, we'll dry some out, but it's really bitter. And Michael says that you can make it more palatable if you combine it with lemongrass or lemon balm. You can sweeten it with honey too, if needed. Michael also mentioned that he's observed vervain tea to have a particular affinity for recovering alcoholics with frequent blood sugar imbalances, emotionally induced vacillation, and an easily excited flushed face. So with the blood sugar imbalance, so this would be good for diabetes as well, which another plant that we'll be discussing is the purple loosestrife, which is not native, and that is really good for lowering blood sugar. The tea taken in the evening soothes the brain, makes sleep less problematic, and in time seem to lessen metabolic brittleness. Good to know. Thank you, Michael.
And with that said, may the harvesting commence. Now we are only going to take the upper parts, and it's still a little early. I'd actually like to harvest once the flowers are a bit more in bloom, but the medicine is here, sure to say, and we'll be keeping the plant alive, and we could get a second bloom because we're only taking the uppermost parts. And I do like to use clippers to help hold the plant intact. Has no unusual fragrance. Just very green vegetative smell. And the taste is mildly bitter. Well, we're going to continue clipping. Michael said the younger, smaller ones, you can use the stem and all. And we'll make that decision back at home. But not harvesting the root, taking Michael's, and we're going to leave that one, and I believe we're going to have plenty for a tincture. But how cool is this, right? Native to America, blue vervain, a sedative. Boy, can't wait to try it. You do that with the snapdragons, right? Just pinch them right at the base and they just open up for you like that, right? Like they're talking. Well, this is a wild snapdragon. Yellow toad flax, or other ways known as eggs and butter, or butter and eggs, I should say. This is a great liver stimulant for chronic alcoholics and people with hepatitis. This is a really, really strong plant. Can bring on diarrhea. So I guess if you're a bit plugged up,
you would want to take something like this in small amounts, because this is a really, really strong plant. It's not native, it's introduced from Europe, and I actually remember reading some time ago where they think that this may be one of the first plants introduced, that the seeds were in the big sacks of grains and wheat and whatnot and the like, coming from Europe, from England, as far back as the Mayflower, the article I had read. But you can see the stems are round. The leaves are really thin, almost grass-like, really, really soft to the touch, almost like a rubber band in a way. You know, it feels to me that same texture. And the leaves, they're actually quite tasty. Kind of tastes like a lettuce. Really nice. And a little peppery on the back end. And once again, truly amazingly, that Michael Moore's book, Medicinal Plants of the Mountain West, has once again came through as being very useful for me. And so with that said, I would like to quote a little from Michael again. And well, remember years ago, you know, herbalists used to love to quote the late greats from the 15th century. Nicholas Culpeper and the famed herbalist, the king's herbalist, John Parkinson. So to quote somebody a little more modern, I think is complimentary of the times. And here, Michael says that a strong, sure, but potentially irritating liver stimulant. So he says, in order for it to work, it's generally used in a combination with other herbs for a liver tonic, cleanser, or flush. As a tonic, let's just say that toad flax stirs things up, causing a moderate scattergun stimulus of liver enzymes and fluid transport. So it's definitely a good liver, which is blood filter, a good blood cleanser. Michael says that it's not for everybody, but combining it in a tea, Michael says, and such herbs as Oregon grape, a yellow dock, and burdock, dandelion, or red root, you know, are cooling and contracting, whereas the first Oregon grape and yellow dock are hot and stimulating. And in combination with that, with the toad flax here, it really is really good for stimulating liver inflammations and hepatitis flare-up. So, well, if you know anyone with hepatitis, this could really help them a lot, or recovering alcoholics, or maybe what about those binge drinkers, those people that go out and really get tanked and feel like crap the next day or for the next couple of days. I think this could be good for them as well. You know, and you know, the irritability and the noticing of the overworked liver feels like, as anything else, to those who have contracted hepatitis, retain a strong memory of their feelings of their illness, and this could really, really help out a lot. Michael says that toad flax seems to have little effect on normal levels of bioreproduction, but will stimulate its secretion when insufficient. And with that said, all you need is the knowledge, people. We have in the wild here a natural pharmacopoeia, and all you have to do is just know a little bit about it, and it could really help you a lot. or help your friends save someone's life. I think we'll harvest it. Got plenty here, and I think we'll make a tincture. And I know one other plant I wanted to go get today, and it's also invasive, and that would be the, I found a small stand of it this morning when I was driving, and that would be the purple loosestrife in combination with our blue vivarium would be a really good help in diabetes for lowering blood sugar. So I would like to do some experiments with that myself. I have all the proper testing, you know, and testing, being able to test sugar levels in the blood. And it'll be fun to do some experiments with that. To use clippers, it's healthier for the plants instead of ripping and tearing as you go. There's no need for that. And geez, we're gonna have to go. We have plenty of jars for bottling the tinctures, but I'm gonna have to go get some more grain alcohol. I really enjoy using grain alcohol, so though sometimes you can get away with like a, you know, maybe an 80 proof vodka, but I like using, like I said, the grain alcohol. And by just clipping the parts, you want to harvest when they're in flower. And most plants, you want to harvest when in flower. A lot of times, if you're harvesting roots, that will kill the plant. Often you can leave a part of a root and it could regenerate. No guarantees on that though. Almost clipped a little piece of mugwort, just try to get in. But well, using a tincture, you know, for this, really makes it a lot easier to combine, you know, with other herbs. And that's why we're going with a tincture once again. Looks like we have a little morning glory mixed in with that. But we have plenty here. But using a tincture, you can use tonics by combining other tinctures to create combinations that work well together. Take just a little sidetrack right now, although it's quite mature and has gone to seed. It loses its classic umbella shaped flowers, but the leaves here still reminiscent of the carrot family, such as Queen Anne's lace. This is poison hemlock, the famed poison hemlock that did in Socrates and a famous poet from Paris, France, that wrote a poem for you to whom I wrote, mentioning poison hemlock as well. To give you an example, I picked some Queen Anne's lace, and you can see, although it's a bit wilted, it's 90 degrees, and it was in my car on the drive home. I had to stop a couple of errands, but you can see the leaves here are a bit of a look-alike, resembling the poison hemlock, you know, in a way. I'm sorry about the wilting, but over here, and here is your classic white umbella. And although this is not the one with the here's one. This and here has the scarlet center, which really is a dead giveaway for the Queen Anne's Lay, so the wild carrot. So just to be advised, you know, here it is. You got to be really, really sure about the plants that you pick, because you don't want to eat something that could kill you or make you really sick, or kill someone that you know or love. That would be probably worse than killing yourself. But here it is. It's really, it's in its gone to seed, quite yellow state right now. But there is a big difference. Queen Anne's Lace is quite fragrant, and this smell is really rank and really, really nasty. If you grabbed a bunch of it and mushed it together and smelt it, it's a terrible smelling plant. So here it is, poison hemlock. Be advised. I had to go pick up some supplies. Now let's go back to the shop here and make some medicine. Well, here we are back at base camp. Yes, and as many of you know, I live in a camper in the woods. About 60 acres. So the inconvenience of tight quarters can be troublesome. Pardon the mess. So, what a day we have had, and we are still going. We need to process this. Here we have our yellow toad flax. We have mason jars. We have grain alcohol, and I picked up some extras over here. We're going to probably need them. We have our blue vervain, the wonderful sedative. I have a bunch of other specimens here, about 15 I collected for further research. And we have this. Our purple loosestrife. Really, really gorgeous, can be quite invasive here in America. Native to Europe. We didn't video harvesting this, but because of the situation, it was just too difficult. But as we can see, off opposite leaves, very thin, smooth, no teeth, and really thick. I was really able to harvest quite a bit. We'll do a tincture and we'll dry the rest. It really is a gorgeous plant. It just stands out. You can see it from far away. But I remember hiking the Appalachian Trail last year in Maine, really the wet areas and the boggy areas. This plant really takes over. And then it pushes out all the native plants, and well, it can be problematic. An invasive species, but it's medicinal. So I suggest everybody get out there and pick their fair share and use it up. Reminds me of a story. Long ago, a woman hired me to come for consultation to her property. She lived against the woods, and she was really worried about all the plants that were encroaching into her space. And as I pointed out all of the plants that were encroaching into her space, I told her that they were all usable and all quite edible. I said, you can get rid of them by chopping them up and eating them. But she looked at me strangely, and I went away, happy to have obliged her as best I could. But some people, they just don't want to hear such things. And I wasn't going to spray the place. I don't do that. So here we are. We're all set up. And I'm not going to video the whole process here. There's a lot of work to be done, so I'll turn the camera on and off in segments until the task is done. It's pretty repetitive. We're going to chop them all up, stuff them in those mason jars, and add the pure grain alcohol to it, compacting as much herb into the jars first, and will give us a 1-to-2, a really strong ratio for medicinal tonics, a tincture. Look at all those beautiful flower heads there. Well, we've stripped off quite a bit. We have this in reserve. I want to stuff this in and see what we got, because anything that won't fit will dry. And so I don't want to strip the leaves off of the stems if I don't need to. Well, remarkably, I can't believe I fit the whole thing. But here we are. It needs to settle. I see air bubbles. I'll have to put some more grain alcohol in a moment. Here's our yellow toad flax. Once again, really a lot of beautiful flowers in here, and it's got some air pockets. So in a little bit, we will, perhaps tomorrow, we will add some more grain alcohol. So here we are, last but not least, the purple loosestrife. And just wanted to, because we didn't do this in the wild, wanted to point out, notice the long, thin lance, opposite sides, lance-shaped leaves. Pardon me. It's been a long day. The stems are square. And the flowers are absolutely just gorgeous. Just look at them. They're just really remarkable. I've seen these all over the place, and you just can't help but stare. You can see them from so far away. So it's been used since the ancient Greeks. The Greeks, I read that they would actually tie garlands, wreaths, around their oxen's necks of this. And they felt it encouraged them to work harder for some reason. I'm sure they had a reason. But they would put it around their oxen to help, you know, cultivate and tend to the fields. The Greeks also used it. It's an astringent, and the Greeks use it to help stop bleeding. It's great for women's menstruation. If they're bleeding heavily, they can use it. It helps stop diarrhea. Helps stop diarrhea in infants that are breastfeeding. So it's really a wonderful, wonderful herb. It helps lower blood glucose. So people that have adult onset type 2 diabetes, this is a natural remedy, a cure. Not a cure, but it will lower your your glucose. I'm having difficulties here. Your glucose levels. So we're going to do some experiments with this later on about that and report its findings. So it's an amazing herb, and we're going to process this now, and our day will be complete. Wow, what a long day. Wow, look at this. I decided to do mostly all just the flower tops of this purple loosestrife. And I failed to mention that it has got a great nectar reward, so it's great for honeybees. I wonder what the honey would taste like if you had your beehives just in a huge field of just this, because they say it's got quite the nectar reward. So this is going to be fun. I'm going to tincture this as is. Oh, and I wanted to go back just briefly about the poison hemlock, and I mentioned Rene Vivien, a French writer in Paris, France, who spoke and wrote of the poison hemlock. She also was, in the 1800s, she was a first wave feminist, and she championed women's rights so long ago, and so her name should not be forgotten. Good grief. Let's bottle this up. Well, and here we have it. Yellow toad flax. A liver stimulant cleanser. Blue vervain, a stimulant or a sedative, I should say, pardon me, a sedative, pain relief, help you sleep. And purple, loose strife. And astringent, help stop bleeding. And helps lower the blood glucose level in type 2 adult onset diabetes. This could be it, folks. This could be the big ticket to help all those people with diabetes. Well, we're going to wrap this up, store it in a dark cabinet, shaking it every day, and then we will process and remove the organic plant material, filter it, and that will be our tincture. We'll decant it, and it'll be good for several years. And the rest of the purple loosestrife is drying, and we will dry it out and bag it for teas. Well, here's a nice patch. This is what we've been looking for. And I think we're going to give them a little bit more time. This is the ghost plants. Many people know them as Indian pipes. And they're really, really gorgeous, I think. Was it Monotropa uniflora? And you dig up the whole plant, roots and all, or plants, and it's a mild sedative. The tincture is actually a very light velvet in color when it's done. But we're out scouting right now for ghost plants. I'll remember where this is. They really are beautiful when they come up, and this really is a nice patch. I would need to find several in order to make a good tincture with it. So we're gonna leave these be and scout out some more. I found a really small edible mushroom called a beefsteak, and the reason being, if you cut it, it will secrete a red liquid. And I found some yellow chanterelles as well, and they'll be supper tonight. But very nice. I'm gonna let these babies come out, and we'll harvest later, providing that I find an abundance. Don't want to over harvest. It's really important. This is Lake Ormbach in Staten Island, New York City. Beautiful, beautiful lake. And you can hear the kids in the background at the beach over there. It's a summer camp for both Cub Scouts and YMCA. Over here we can still see some white azaleas still blooming, still holding on. This is one of my favorite spots, because this is my favorite blueberry bush. And it really has some enormous blueberries. Wow, not quite ready yet. But this one looks a little better. A couple there dropped. They look pretty ripe. But more to come. But I love this bush. The berries are enormous on it. And I'll often will come here to feed. I know we're veering off slightly with our medicinal herb format here, but this is a Boletus bicolorus, and in the genus Boletus there's about 600 various species, and a few of them are bitter, but not a one that I know of is actually poisonous. This is actually one of my favorite tasting mushrooms. The aroma is really sweet. You want to do a dry saute. This is really fresh. you would want to wait another week, not much later than that, or they'll get really buggy. The beetles love to lay their eggs in these, and then the larvae will eat throughout the mushroom, and it's hard to get the bugs out. But this is a beautiful, beautiful mushroom, and the colors sometimes are absolutely amazing. And here's one. Well, it broke off, but they can get really enormous. I'd say this broke off by itself, and that flesh. Unlike the king bolet, which is equally as big, the king bolet, the flesh is white. And the boletus, and you can see all the holes already from the beetle larvae as they penetrate and eat their way all the way through. But yeah, that baby broke off right there. But yeah, it's a little spent, but delicious, delicious. And you just never know what you might find. There's a pretty decent sized snapper. I would say she's laying eggs. Or maybe finished laying eggs. Usually you don't see them out of the water unless they're doing just that. Very cool. Well, and by further examination, we see looks like a little robin fledgling there. Did it catch it and start to feed on it? I think not. I think it's just purely coincidence, because it would just gobble the whole thing up. And here's another small clump of ghost plants just starting to come up. So I think in another week I'll be able to find enough to make a proper tincture. So what I'll probably do is keep scouting out, make mental notes of all the spots where I find these beauties, and then come back when enough of them are up, and then I'll harvest them all together. They're very fragile. They're almost like a mushroom. And pick them all at the same time, and prepare the tincture right here in the field. They're that fragile. Well, here we have some yarrow, and take notice of the umbella. It's white, like the Queen Anne's lace, but there's no center scarlet, red, purple flower like the Queen Anne's lace, the wild carrot. The leaves are similar, but not exact. So it is a look-alike to, well, poison hemlock as well, but you can see it's nearly more similar to Queen Anne's lace than anything else when you've familiarized yourself. In the umbella, the flower petals are a little bit larger than the Queen Anne's lace. We have another one right over here. And yarrow. We're not going to pick this, but if you had a fever coming on, you make a tea and it'll really turn up the heat. So what yarrow does is it helps you help your body get better by, you know, a fever. A fever is going to clean you out, and then you break the fever, but first you have to have the fever. So you make a hot cup of tea with yarrow here, and it'll make you sweat. And it will really, you know, you'll sweat out that sickness, and that's what it does. It helps your body by letting the body do its necessary functions. You need a fever, and you need to sweat it out. So don't suppress it. let it happen, encourage it. Yarrow. Very awesome. And here is some Queen Anne's lace, and notice how the flower petals are much smaller. And although there's not the purplish floret in the center, I wanted you to notice the leaves, and notice how different, you know, the leaves are lacy, but look at how less compact they are. You know, they are more spread out. And almost a little sparse, and actually looks a little bit more like a carrot than the yarrow. But remember the yarrow, how it was, if it's still fresh in our minds here, where the leaves were much more dense. And there's another way to tell. And another way to tell, I pulled this. Here's the taproot. And although you're not going to be able to take part in this demonstration, but if you scrape the surface and you really, it smells just like a carrot, because it is. Well, here we are back in this rich, fertile woods, and we have a bunch of Indian pipes, I guess is the common name, but I've always called them ghost plants, but that's me. So we're in a nice area where a bunch have come up in pockets everywhere. And here's some that are pretty spent, and they're already starting to turn. Notice that they have already pollinated and are standing straight up. And there are groups of them in a nice patch here. So we'll go through here and harvest what is harvestable and leave the rest. So let's go over here. These are really cool looking. Now that is pretty as a picture. All right, ghost plants, Indian pipe, Monotropa uniflora, the genus and species. They're white. They don't produce chlorophyll. And I've heard mixed stories whether they're parasites or they have a symbiotic relationship. It's one or the other. Oops, sorry. But that's for sure. According to herbalist Patricia Howell, whom I might quote a few passages here briefly, said that they have a symbiosis relationship with molds and fungus. And you probably can't find this online. You can't grow them, so they have to be found in the wild and harvested. So it's a sedative. It's a really strong sedative, actually. The Cherokee used to use it, and it's compatible to morphine. Imagine that. And they grow in a scaled singular stalk and terminate with one nodding flower. And that's pretty much it. You harvest the whole plant, roots and all, you rinse them well. And because they are so fragile, and they're like many mushroom species, that one like the shaggy mane for Corypharunus, they're so fragile, you pick them up, and when they're growing too, and we'll see many of them here that are turning, and they just turn black and this dissolve back into the soil when they are done. But this is really an awesome, awesome color. Look at these. They're almost pink here. And really, the only way to prepare it, or the best way for sure, would be in a tincture. And the best way to do it is to prepare it on site. So we're really close to a lake, and I have been gathering for a while. So we're going to shoot a little video here of harvesting, and then we're going to go down by the lake and rinse them off real nice. You know, the roots have a lot of dirt in there, so we're going to try to get as much dirt. And I have various sized jars because I wasn't sure about the quantity that I was going to harvest today. So With that said, I have various sized jars and we'll see where this will go, but I want to prepare them as soon as possible. And when they're done, and like all our tinctures, we'll jar it up and we'll put it in a dark cabinet, and every day we'll shake it a bit. And in 4 to 6 weeks, we will strain the organic plant material and we'll just have a pure tincture, and it's the color will be violet. And so I'm really excited about that. That's gonna look really cool. But can you believe a sedative is equal to morphine? Now, I don't know if it's habit forming, and so we'll have to look into that. But yeah, let's get the tripod set up and let's do some harvesting.
Well, I was really hoping to conclude this video with some harvesting of ghost plants. The soil is a bit more sandy than where I was finding them really, really, and really thick, really fertile soils deep in the forest here. We're really close to a lake now. The soil's become a little bit more sandy, but there's a lot of roots in here that they could tap into for sure. And now the interesting thing about cymbosis and with the fungi is that the famous mycologist, Paul Stamens, I believe in his book he wrote, Mycelium Running, made mention that, yeah, fungus, the mycelium of fungus, a mushroom, is just the fruiting body of something much larger that grows underneath a mycelium. It's usually a white, cottony, lacy looking mat. And that is the main orgasm. Wow, I'd say that would be a Freudian slip if he wasn't a fraud. But anyways, we'll let that roll. Oops-a-daisy moment there. But, you know, the mycelium, the larger of the organism, taps into the root systems of trees and plants and cause a symbiotic relationship where they extend the chain and the roots extend so far and then they extend even further because of the mycelium attaching to it, and they share the whole ecosystem and feed each other. And they say the ghost plants, or Patricia Howell does anyways, and she wrote a fabulous book. By the way, I read it some time ago, Medicinal Plants of Southern Appalachians. I believe she is from the Midwest, maybe Illinois, since she moved to, I believe, North Carolina, and has been there for many decades now. And you look her up online, she speaks really well. She's got some great YouTube videos. And she wrote here, I'm going to read a little bit from this in a little bit, but let's continue with the harvesting here. And we want the roots and all, and it's really difficult to say the least. And they're really fragile, so we need to be careful. And we have, you know, harvested quite a few already, but we're going to do the whole tincturing in just a few moments here in the lake, because we need to wash. Oh dear. Alright. Sometimes harvesting can be really tedious, but there is no commercial method of growing the ghost plant. So any ghost plants that you're going to find as medicine will be harvested wild. And that's all there is to it. So there's not a real big market for it, and they say that you should maybe start with 40 drops, you know, and just kind of experiment with the dose until the pain goes away. more smaller doses are better than one large one,
and you shouldn't use it for more than a month. I mean, this baby is strong, but it won't give you the drowsy side effects that a lot of painkillers will do. So, but caution is always the best policy, and use small amounts and see how your body reacts to it. But
this could be the pain relief that you need. And as the great Michael Moore, such a great and wonderful herbalist from out west, would say, the herb you need just might be the herb you have. So when you're out in the wild, you know, you're limited to what's available in the biosphere, the ecosystem that you're in. So I'm not sure if these babies grow out west or not. I haven't read anything about that, the nature of that, but yeah, it's a little time consuming, the harvesting here, but it pays off. We'll just rinse that. And all this will be separated on the lake. What a treat. It's a beautiful lake. Lake Orenbach here. And we're on our way. Still uncertain until I clean them on what size jar to use. Now, I brought a few different sizes, just uncertain of how many I will find. So here, don't want to, you know, waste too much feed time, but let's read a little bit from Patricia Caritzi Howell. I probably didn't say that second name correctly, but you get the meaning of it anyways. I try. So, let's start with her description. Indian Pike is a distinctive white semi-transparent perennial. A saporific plant that contains no chlorophyll. Indian pipe is unable to process sunlight. For nutrients, it relies on the symbiotic relationship with molds and other fungi, found in the decaying leaf humus at the base of trees. This small plant, only 4 to 6 inches tall, consists of a scaled tube-like stalk that ends in a nodding solitary white flower. It grows in clumps, and it looks like a cluster of small white pipes with their stems stuck into the ground. As the flower blooms between June and September, Indian pipe slowly straightens into the upright position, with the flower pointing eventually towards the sky. The flowers have no fragrance. After pollination, or if disturbed, Indian pipe turn black and dissolves. They lie deeply shaded, moist woodlands, usually in acidic soil, beneath rhododendrons and mountain laurel. Well, we don't have either one here. And here she says, this plant was well known to be the Cherokee, The Cherokee was well known to the Cherokee as a plant remedy of the highest order, she says, comparable to morphine. That's really incredible. The use of Indian pipe is limited due to the fragile nature of the plant itself and the lack of commercial sources. Indian pipe dulls the perception of pain without causing drowsiness. That is helpful. And to relieve specific types of pain,
you know, and they say you can pair it with willow. We know willow, aspirin. And anti-spasmatics, they say black cohosh. And that's another plant. Actually, grows out west, too. That's a very, very great plant that we'll be discussing later in another video. So there are no known methods for cultivating Indian pipe. All plants are gathered from the wild because its native habitat is dwindling. The use of Indian pipe is limited to small-scale use by individuals with access to sites like us. So thank you, Patricia. And we're going to commence some more harvesting.
And here these babies have seen better days. And you can see down below there's some down there that are already turned black. So I'm gonna filter through this whole group here and then we'll get to processing.
Well, I guess I should have worn my shorts and sandals, but oh well. We have a pretty nice collection here. I was doing a lot of washing because it's very time consuming, and one thing I try to do and not go on and make long running empty videos that are not entertaining. So by bearing with me, it's really cool that they float. And so that has been helpful in preparing my want to get that beautiful violet color. But how much roots do I use? And usually when I strain out the mark, MARC, which is the remaining spent vegetative material, when it's all done, and most, you know, unless you're using flowers, most tinctures are green or some shade of green because of the chlorophyll in the leaves that we use often. And often I will strain out the mark with just a bandana, but I'm afraid on this one here we're gonna have to do a second filtering. Thought I felt something under there. Are fish swimming all around me, but I just don't want a snapping turtle to, you know, think I'm lunch. One of my little toes being a piece of bait or something. So I'm really torn between this as far as the how much root material. It seems like I have much more of above ground, I should say, material. And it looks like we're going to get away. As we know, you know, we can really stuff a lot in a jar. So I think, and surprisingly, I'm happy that we're going to be able to use the larger jar that I brought. Wow, that's a lot of ghost plants. And like I said, I sure would love to see that violet tincture, but oh goodness, there's a lot of plant material here. Wow. And it's really early in the season. They're just, as you noticed there, they're just starting to come up. And so there are plenty out there. I'm sure that, you know, they're all under the leaf litter, and we've probably walked past hundreds of clumps, actually. Like I said, really, really uncertain about this. Oh, good grief. We might have to use a second jar. This is really exciting, but we will stuff as much. And this is going to give us, once again, a 2-to-1 ratio. This is going to be really potent, no doubt about it. Yeah, we're going to use a second jar, no doubt. Good thing I brought. This is
It's from Poland, I should say. But it's a pure grain alcohol. In America, we have a pure grain alcohol. It goes by Everclear. You can buy it pretty much all over the country, but California, I believe. And wow. And really, it looks like that's about all I can fit. Most of y'all know me from my backpacking videos. And in my backpacking videos, I'm pretty much skinny as a stick, I would say, right? But I've been home, and so I've been weight training, you know, getting in shape. Or I'm always in shape, but you know what I mean. Just a little something extra. Good grief. Yeah. Well, like I said, we have plenty of jars. Plenty of jars. Oh, this is so awesome. And like I said, this could be the pain relief that you need. But yeah, I'm definitely gonna run this baby through a coffee filter. I go backpacking, I usually start off the trail around 225, 230. Usually when I get off the trail, I'm down to 180. That's like my high school weight, which is, well, here we go. That's it. We're gonna do another one here and take it home. I think we could have probably got away with preparing it. Would have used a lot of water though in my camper to clean them out. So we're gonna go ahead and do that, pack things up, and go home. Well, here we are at the final segment of this video presentation, and we've been busy. And in this final segment, we'll recap on a lot of our tinctures here, and including the dried motherwort, which is really good for, well, if you're feeling down and blue or troubled by some foolish games, motherwort will make you feel just fine. It's really calming. It's really good for women's menstrual cramps. It's an antispasmatic. And it'll really help the melancholy blues as well. A nice hot cup of tea using a couple of teaspoons of the motherwort, and boil up a pot of water. And it really has a calming effect. And like I said, I use it often. So what do we have here? We've been busy, like I said. And this is a sedative native here to North America, blue vervain. And it does will make you drowsy, and it'll help you sleep. It's really good for sick children that are struggling to get better, and they can't sleep, and they're really cranky. This will help calm them down, and you as well. And here, a non-native from Europe, this is purple loosestrife. And many qualities, and I want to home in on it's really good for adult onset type 2 diabetes. It'll help lower your glucose level, your blood sugar level. Over here, we have a motherwort tincture that is still in its preparing stages. And over here, we have a liver tonic. This is another non-native. This is from Europe, and it is yellow toad flax. And once again, we are still working on the process. Needs a good 5 weeks, I would say. And yesterday, we had bottled up this tincture of the ghost plants, or most known, I have found out, as Indian pipe. But I will always call them ghost plants, and it's really amazing. The tincture is going to be a violet color, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's one into one day, and we got 5 weeks to go here, and it is on its way. But something that we have not presented on video, because I had harvested this before I decided to shoot this video of herbs processing and the history and everything that we can think of. This is, I call it heal all. It's also known as self-heal. And all of these herbs have been used for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. And heal all is one. And it is really good for mouth injuries. It's in modern use, it's geez, they've been using it for HIV and hepatitis. But it's really known for healing mouth injuries. You go to the dentist, you're having some side effects after some dental work. You know, maybe you've got some sores on your gums or whatever. This will heal it. It's really good for the mouth and throat. But it's also good for external wounds and internal wounds as well. And as far as like a cold, it's really good for fighting all types of viruses. So you could actually take a tincture here, you know, maybe a couple teaspoons, and mix it in with some honey, and it'll really not only help heal your throat. Let's say you had a sore throat, some laryngitis, went to a very loud football game or concert, and your throat is really rough. Yeah, mix a little bit of this with some honey, and not only its healing properties, but the honey, as far as soothing and coating the throat, would be good. So what we are doing is the final process. We have the bottle in ready, and now what we are going to do is strain the organic plant material into another vessel, and then we'll transfer it to this, and then we will mark it and date it and be good to go for several years or longer if it lasts that long. But it's a remarkable herb. So I think that we'll get started. And once again, we picked this, a good 5 weeks ago. But I've been trying to do the continuity of this video presentation. And therefore, I saved this process for last. And this pretty much, like I said, this wraps up this video presentation. So often I'll just use a bandana for almost everything as far as filtering. And wow, this is going to make a beautiful emerald green tincture when it's all bottled. Jeez. Really looking more and more like an alchemist's lab every day, which is a good thing. And I am going to stop for just a moment. We've got to pull this out and run it and wring it out through here. So I'm going to take a moment. I don't want to make a mess. And I want to make sure that I get it all right. So I'm going to get another pan and pull this out of here. And then we'll bring it into here. It's really amazing how much plant material. And this is now called a mark, M-A-R-C. And we will bring out all this good medicine. The best we can. Now imagine if I had a food processor, I could just run that mark right through that baby and get every drop of liquid out of it. But we're just going to do it the old-fashioned way.
pretty fascinating. Not too bad. We've got, this is our final step. And like I mentioned, I didn't video the harvesting of this. You'll find it everywhere. It's probably, you've seen it probably in your lawn. It really grows nicely in people's lawns. And you'll find it coming up in early spring. Jeez, I really should use a funnel for this. I don't have a funnel. I'm gonna have to get a funnel. I mean, I have a funnel, but it's out back in my powerhouse for oil changes, so that won't work out well. But in a pinch, adapt and overcome. Well, mind, body, spirit. We'll take the rest of this and we'll mix it up with a batch of, you know, some honey, and set that aside. Labeling and dating everything. Well, folks, that really worked well, and I really have been enjoying making this video presentation immensely. And I thought that this we need more of this out here, but wow. Very cool. Well, we don't really have much sun here to really shine the light. But I have been really enjoying reading excerpts from some of my books. Now this, the Herbalist Bible, was first written by John Parkinson in 1640, he was a botanist in London. He later became the king's herbalist of King Charles I. There was never a King Charles II because there was a revolution, and well, King Charles I was put to death. But fortunately, the king's herbalist survived. Good thing. And he wrote a book, a monstrosity, Magnus Opus, had 1,788 pages, almost 1,800 pages, a big book too. And so, and he was writing along the same time as Nicholas Culpeper was, and it was really hard to publish this book because it was a monstrosity, but covered everything well. And it was very costly to publish such a beast, so it never really was, you know, and it was expensive, so it had to be accordingly to the purchase of the book. It had to be passed down, so it wasn't really received well in the public. And other books, Culpeper had just published a book prior to that. But the point is that two people, Julie Burton Seal and Matthew Seal, had bought a copy, mortgaged their house, and found, not a copy, but found one of the Magnus Opus from John Parkinson, and they wrote this. And they show, well, we're going to open it up because we're going to read a little bit. We're not going to read here in this side here. And this is the self-heal. And here's a drawing of the plant. Here's a photo of the plant if you've seen it. And it comes up and then the flowers are all in a big cluster up top. And they're really, really small, almost like a creeping plant. And it has runners. So look in your backyard, look in your front yard, and you'll find it in the early spring. It could be out there still today, but it really gets going early in the season. So here is his writing, and we're not going to read from that because, well, quite honestly, back then in 1640, the English people, they didn't really speak English. Well, not like American English, that's for sure. And it's really fun to read, because it really takes you back in time. Oh my gosh, 1640, we were, just a colony. Imagine that. So, here, they say, self-heal, also called all-heal, from its reputation has a wide range of medicinal effects, and the primary treatment for disease of the mouth and throat, possibly type of quinsy, an effect against mouth ulcers, if you get a wound in your mouth. Its other main use in Europe was for wounds and injuries of all kinds, from broken bones to bleeding cuts in China. It was given to clear liver stagnation and congestion, and to treat and reduce swellings, especially in the neck. And it's widely used for fevers. And here in modern use, so we're going to skip down to here, and it says in modern use here, it has a great effect against the viruses, including HIV and viral hepatitis, and it has a antibiotic, great effect against a large range of bacterias. So it'll help reduce the fever, it'll bring out sweats if you make a tea with it. And you could use it as an eye wash also by using a little salt water and mixing with this. Well, you wouldn't want to use the tincture, that would, the alcohol would hurt. And we didn't actually dry any out, we just, we harvested it for a tincture this time, but perhaps in the future we'll dry some out for teas later. But I just wanted to conclude with this last talk here and reading from a book. Don't be afraid of knowledge. You can never learn too much. You should always be learning. I'm always learning and I'm always growing. And this is a wrap. Thank you so much for your tenderness and kindness, and I hope this video is useful. God bless.